Hey gang, happy Easter, and for a bit of a change of pace, we're doing a religious picture, or something I like to call biblical noir. It's all about a Roman centurion sent to investigate the disappearance of Jesus' body after his crucifixion, or as he's called in this film, Yeshua, which I believe is the correct pronunciation in the Hebrew text. Anyway, as you can see, we are very much in our Roman attire here, and also our detective attire. All right, so it's a silly gag. I won't do any more. Anyways, the film opens with a centurion named Clavius wandering in the deserts of Judea. And he comes upon a little, I guess you'd call it a hostel or little inn or something, where he gets something to eat. And when the proprietor asks him why he's there, he tells his story. And it starts with him rather brutally ending a rebellion.
I know how this ends.
Then tell Yahweh you are coming, courtesy of Mars.
It must pain you to know that the one true God chooses us over you.
But not today, he didn't.
When the Messiah comes, Rome will be nothing!
Until then.
Yeah, so we establish Clavius as a rather bloodthirsty, cold-blooded killer. When he returns to the city, he is summoned by Pilate. He has something very important to discuss with him.
I was here stirring the pot.
Some ascetic, one of following by making waves to the Sanhedrin, decided to put him down. Sent a lathered mob here screaming for his blood because he claims to be their Messiah.
I had to crucify him.
Yep. He's come back just in time for the end of Jesus' torment. Pilate wants him to go out to where the men have been crucified and make sure this is ended, and that this man is dead, and that all talk of being a Messiah in the uprising is quashed. He also gives him a sidekick, Lucius, who is the son of one of Pilate's friends. And as they head out, something strange happens.
Poseidon's unhappy.
Sun God is.
Well, yes, that is Draco Malfoy as Lucius. Ironically, the actor who played Draco Malfoy, Tom Felton, has in this film the name of the character of his father from the Harry Potter series. Crazy, huh? Anyway, the earthquake is a foreshadowing of what they'll find. It seems Jesus has already passed, but to make sure, he has a centurion or a guard or whatever get a spear and stab him in the side. He's passed. Feeling of remorse or charity, take your pick, he allows Jesus' relatives to take him to his own burial instead of throwing him in the pit with the others. Although he does roll a rock in front of it to make sure the body's not stolen. But the temple elders, they feel that there will be an attempt made to steal the body. And this will cause his martyrdom to be even more important to the people, and they will say that he is risen and fulfilled the prophecy of the Messiah. So, Clavius and Lucius head out to check.
Seal it.
Seal.
So, it looks like everything's fine. Some guards are left on duty. That is, until the next day.
As if they burst.
Is he gone? You tell me.
The body, was it anointed?
We have no time. We just wrapped him with myrrh and aloe.
That's what you see. Sweat and herbs, bring it.
Yep. The Shroud of Turin. Well, of course, they believe that someone has come in and stolen him. And the guards that were on duty, they are at the temple seeking protection from the elders, because they know Pilate will probably put them to death for failure. When Clavius, who's now put in charge of finding the body, goes to talk to one of the guards, the other's too afraid to see him. He is told the story that they were attacked and they were subdued, and the people rolled the stone away and lit off with the body. And then he mentions that they cut the ropes that were holding the stone. Clavius knows they're lying. He also confronts the man with about the drinking, and he admits they were drinking, but they were still alert, and they got snuck up on. So he begins to round up everyone that even mentions Messiah. There's a little montage of him questioning different people, and then one lets go with the idea of he should talk to Mary Magdalene, a woman of the streets. Not knowing what she looks like, he goes to the barracks and finds a man that does, and while they're on stakeout, gives some advice that he will probably come back to hurt him later.
Later that night, down in the valley, we heard them screaming. And looked up to see them staked out on the ridgetops so we could watch. That is why you offer no quarter.
No time to ponder that. We've got an action sequence to get to. Clavius has a bit of a sense of humor there, greeting her with a traditional Hebrew greeting. Questioning Mary gives him nothing. All she talks about is how great Jesus was and how he's still here with us right now here in that room. And he comes to believe she is off her rocker. So lets her go, and they manage to finally track down one of the disciples, Bartholomew. Again, he gets no clear answers. The man seems to be just out of his mind. So he lets him go, but well, waiting to hear word from his informant, he's sent to trail Bartholomew. Glavius has been having all the cemeteries in the area, the Jewish cemeteries, dug up to search the bodies. This is not sitting well with the Jewish community. But they're going to argue with a bunch of soldiers? Pilate's not too pleased with it, but they do find a body that seems they have the correct markings of crucifixion and the correct wound in the side. Now, the face is too deteriorated to tell anything. That can't really tell if this is or not their man. Clavius says, go ahead and announce it. You've got a body. That should quell any talk that he's worried about there being any kind of an uprising. So that when Caesar comes from his visit from Rome, everything's fine. Pilate's not too sure. He's ever the canny politician. But though he has been ordered to get ready to move out to another battle, Clavius still keeps investigating, and he tracks down the other guard. They've been pardoned by Pilate, no doubt with some bribery from the temple elders. And he finally gets the truth of what happened the night the body disappeared.
Until we was wakened by this terrible... This terrible flash. The night was gone. And the air smelt burned and the ropes, they just exploded. And the stone flew like a leaf and all of a sudden the sun rose in the tomb.
Not quite sure how to fathom that story. But Clavius believes the man's telling the truth. He's not sure how such a thing's possible. But luckily his gamble with the informer is paid off. And he tells Clavius where the disciples are meeting. They're on this specific street. Doesn't know which room, but they're on that street. So Clavius' soldiers start to search. Clavius himself finds the room, sees Jesus alive. It's impossible. He's gobsmacked. And he tells his men that the disciples aren't here to return to the barracks, which they do. Then he goes into the room and Jesus greets him by name. And as he sits there stunned, he sees the signs of crucifixion on his hands, spear wound in the side. And then Jesus performs another miracle.
Yeshua.
Not to worry. Jesus told Mary, got something in the way here. Jesus told Mary, you will see the disciples again at Galilee. So they immediately grab everything and head out. Clavius leaves a message behind and follows them.
Do not seek me. Do not follow or wander. Persecute no one on my behalf. I have seen two things which cannot reconcile. A man dead without question, and that same man alive again. I pursue him, the Nazarene, to ferret the truth.
Well, that doesn't sit well with Pilate. Feeling Clavius is turned against him, he commissions Lucius to get a group of men together and head out after them, to bring Clavius back. Alive, if possible. Dead, preferable. Meanwhile, Clavius is following the disciples from a distance. He's without supplies. Finally, after a day's journey, Simon Peter brings him some water and invites him to join them as they eat some bread. And the next day, he is now part of the group. But he is a soldier, and looking behind him, he spots the pursuers, and he uses all the tricks he's learned throughout his career to evade them. But Lucius was a good student, too.
Officiati, please. No quarter tribune. That's what you taught. A bad lesson.
But Lucius, he's also forgotten who he's dealing with.
No one dies today. No one.
He lets Lucius go. And they continue on to Galilee. No one's there. But there are some boats. So, being hungry, they go fishing. But they fish all night. Can't catch anything. The next morning, a stranger on the shore tells them they should try casting their net on the right side.
What happened?
Thief!
We just did! We're stuck!
He's stuck in a rock!
Hoist the net and
he's caught on something!
It's fish.
It's fish.
Realizing who the man on the shore must be, they all rush to him. And they sit around, have a good fish dinner. And then Clavius sees Jesus perform one of his more notable miracles.
No one touches me.
A miracle. We saw them many times, Roman.
Yep, he cured a leper. One of the many times he's done this in the scriptures. That night, Clavius finally is able to talk with Jesus.
I cannot reconcile all this with the world I know. With your own eyes you've seen, yet still you doubt. Imagine the doubt of those who never see. That's what they face. When you died, I was present. I helped.
I know.
Is it you say, Clavius? Certainty? Peace? A day without death?
The the very same words he spoke to the pilot at one point earlier in the film. That was a really long conversation he had, very whispered, that's why it's so low, but I just gave you the highlights there. The next morning, Jesus bids them all goodbye.
I know that I will be with you. Always.
And so, with Jesus returning to the Father and having bid his disciples to go and spread the word, they all make plans to separate and go to different places and preach the gospel. Simon Peter invites Clavius to join them, but he has his own path to go, apparently. Meanwhile, Lucius returns with his disappointing news to Pilate, and Pilate says something that will probably live to regret.
I doubt we'll ever hear from them again.
His story finish. Clavius leaves one of his rings as payment for the food and continues his wandering. Apparently, to tell his story to someone else and spreading the gospel in his own way, as he still tries to fathom whether it was true or not. That's a very interesting film. A little too arty for my tastes, and not as much police procedural as the trailers had it look like back in 2016 when it was released. And I was a little disappointed in that. I mean, it does have some with him questioning people, having them brought to his office and questioning them, more like threatening. But I was expecting something a little more detective-oriented than what it really was. I just think it was mispromoted, because that's not really the point of the film. The point of it is to see a man in a crisis of faith experience a renewal of faith in a different deity, as he goes from worshiping Mars to Yahweh. I was disappointed as the film was progressing that there wasn't as more detective stuff, but by the end of the film, I was kind of uplifted by it, which I'm sure was what you're supposed to get from it. Being a Lutheran, it was kind of nice to see Josephinus in another biblical film, as he had the title role in the Martin Luther biopic, Luther. So, you know. And, it's a good film for what it is, and I enjoyed it. And as a Christian, of course, I really like the ending. And it just gets me right here. And for those who complain there's no monster in this, what do you think Pilate was? He's a politician. What bigger monster is that? But and it's Easter, so I thought this would be a good film to highlight for the season. And really not much else to say about it. It didn't make a lot of money, and critics didn't really care for it. But it's a nice little film, not too preachy, and it doesn't condemn anyone or anything. I mean, this is the way it was then, and Jesus forgave his tormentor. And what's more Jesus than that? When you think about it. Well, please hit like, share, and subscribe. Stay after my credits for my favorite scene, which is a bit humorous.
Who among you knows the woman Mary Magdalene?